Graduands, guests and colleagues, my name is Mary Howarth and I am delighted to welcome you all to graduation. I have a few announcements to make before we begin so that you can relax and enjoy the ceremony. Graduands, an easy job to start with. Please check that your seat number matches the number on your ticket because you'll be called to the stage in this order. If you discover that these do not match, our team of stewards can help you locate the correct seat. At the appropriate time, you'll be invited by the stewards to stand and to make your way to the foot of the stairs, ready to head up the stairs and across the stage. All very straightforward. There are two key things which make for a seamless ceremony. Firstly, as soon as the person ahead of you begins to cross the stage, please make sure you make your way up the stairs. Please don't wait until they pass across the stage before you reach the top of the stairs. Secondly, don't let excitement and pride overwhelm you so much that you forget to pick up your degree parchment after you've crossed the stage. If you do, don't worry, you have still graduated. But don't try to go back because you will collide with someone coming the other way. Instead, please visit the graduation information desk in the Spring Lane building 30 minutes after the ceremony to collect your parchment. At the end of the ceremony, graduates are asked to process out of the hall directed by the stewards. Family and friends, the stewards will show you to the exits once the graduates have left the hall. If the fire alarm should sound at any time, please remain in your seats. Instructions will be given and will escort you to the nearest exit. As graduates, you will join an international community of over 130,000 alumni in 183 countries. York's Global Alumni Association organises events, networks and services designed to help you make connections with other alumni across the world and to support your career prospects. So please visit the Alumni Association stand and photo booth in the Spring Lane building where you can pick up your graduation gift to welcome you to the Alumni Association. As you get your first job or take up further study or training, please remember to keep us in touch with what you're doing. Understanding the career paths that you take will help us provide the right support for current students and make sure we offer graduates, like you, the best information and opportunities that we can. Finally, please turn your mobile phones to silent and will you all now please stand?
Good afternoon and welcome to the University. I have great pleasure in declaring the congregation open for the conferment of awards. Please have a seat. So again, good afternoon and welcome to this very exciting day, which is a special milestone in your lives. This is also a wonderful time of the year for everyone who works in the university. It's really inspiring to see so many happy and proud people here today. I want to offer you my warmest and most sincere congratulations. Gaining your degree from a world-class university like York is a tremendous achievement. It shows just how much you've devoted your best efforts to your studies. The university is enormously proud of you, as are your families, your partners, and your friends, and indeed everybody else who has supported you throughout your time here. When you made the decision to come to the university, you made a choice that's likely to have a lasting effect on the rest of your life. As I'm sure you know, there are many reasons why people go to university. Perhaps you came to York because you wanted to prepare for a career in your chosen field, or to improve your employment prospects. Perhaps you came because you were passionate about your subject, or perhaps you just wanted to leave home. Well, whatever the reason, we hope you achieved your personal aims and ambitions. In recent years, the public discourse around higher education has revolved around universities as drivers of economic growth, personal remuneration, and also the role of higher education in delivering productive workforces. Whereas such constructs are undoubtedly important, we shouldn't lose sight of the much wider relevance of higher education for society. Education is a common good that benefits us all in ways that may be difficult to measure, but are certainly no less important. Education enables societies to work together, to build together, and to live peacefully together. Education protects us from extremism, intolerance, and prejudice. Fundamentally, education makes us better people. I hope that you use your newfound skills to the benefit of people and societies worldwide. Now, I hope you've enjoyed your time at the university, which I'm sure wasn't spent completely on hard work and intellectual contemplation. We've seen and heard you having a wonderful time in your colleges and indeed in the city. I am, of course, also aware of what goes on through social media. Unfortunately, Instagram holds few secrets. And do you know what this says about you? It shows that you are, on the whole, a lively, sociable, and caring group of people with a great zest for life. And so it should be. Being at university is about much more than just study and work. During your time with us, you will have met people who will remain friends for the rest of your life. You will have joined student societies or explored new interests. You will have experienced life in a community that is diverse and truly international. I think that you'll find that these experiences have been just as valuable as any formal learning in shaping who you are and what you can become. Since the university was founded in 1963, we have inspired over 130,000 people to cross both this platform and also continents and embrace almost every imaginable job and profession. Now it's your turn to go out and explore the world. As graduates, you will be part of our worldwide community of alumni, with members from 183 countries across the world. Our global directory ranges from Afghanistan to Zimbabwe. And I hope that you'll be able to join us at events across the globe and to support many of our important activities. Whether joining a professional network or volunteering time as an online mentor, There's a reason for everyone to remain involved with our university. We are fundamentally a community, and a community that still absolutely adheres to our founding principles of excellence, equality, and opportunity for all. One key element of our work is philanthropy, where we come together to support areas such as scholarships, which open doors to education for students who've overcome immense difficulty to be here. That's why a key theme of our New York Unlimited Philanthropy campaign is raising money to enable every student to shine, so that anyone who can benefit from a York education has the opportunity to do so. I know that many of you have already raised funds to support the next generation of students, and in so doing, you have played a vital role in ensuring your successors will benefit from scholarship provision. So a really big thank you to you. It is a tradition that speeches at graduation ceremonies close by offering much well-intended advice to inspire graduates. Well, actually, I'm not sure you particularly need my advice. But there are some things that probably matter more than anything else. First, try to be kind and compassionate to other people, because kindness and compassion underpin civil society. Second, never forget that the world is a very interesting place. Never stop questioning and trying to understand it better. And third, make sure you enjoy whatever you do, and certainly have the courage to change direction if you don't. And finally, be lucky. But do remember that Louis Pasteur said that chance favours only the prepared mind. So, for now, I wish you all well. Make us proud, and above all else, always strive to be the best that you can be. And being York graduates, I'm sure you'll have a lot of fun along the way. So, many congratulations and good luck for your future. Thank you.
As we celebrate the achievements of our students, we also wish to pay tribute to the staff who've contributed to your success. York has an excellent record of outstanding teaching, and what students will remember long after today are the individual members of staff and graduate teaching assistants who have guided, supported, and inspired them. The Vice-Chancellor's Teaching Awards recognize and reward both individuals and teams who have made an outstanding contribution to the student learning experience. All holders of these awards have demonstrated excellence in their teaching or the support they provide for learning, delivered with energy, care, and commitment. Today, a Vice-Chancellor's Teaching Award is made to Cinzia Bacilleri from the Department of Language and Linguistic Science. A Vice-Chancellor's Teaching Award is being made to Marina Noelia Canzaruti from the Department of Language and Linguistic Science. A Vice-Chancellor's Teaching Award is made to Dr. Jed Mears from the York Law School. And a Vice-Chancellor's Teaching Award is being made to Dr. Emma Waring of York Law School.
Vice-Chancellor, I have the honour to present the following candidates for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy in Language and Communication for research in elicitations in Chilean English classrooms, Caterina Valper Gormaz. For the degree of Doctor of Philosophy in Linguistics, for research in phonetic convergence in Hong Kong English, Wenling Cao. For research in the linguistic properties of threatening messages, Sarah Kelly. For research in a comparative study of North and South Korean, Moon Shin. For research in phonetic variation and spoken threat perception, James Tompkinson. For research in accent discrimination in UK and US courts, Grace Wood. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in English Language and Linguistics, Sophie Annett. Amy Benner. Ryan Branigan. Laura Butler. Amelia Chippendale. Nicole Chivers. Abigail Dodds. Charlotte Elsie. Alexandra Faulkner. Catherine Fenton. Megan Fraser. Elizabeth Good. Julia Cass Hebron. Eve Hunter. Eleanor Jeffries. Georgia Langdon. Pearl Puying Law. Edward Lee. Tara Leggett. Helen Millian. Annabel Page. Heather Page. Emma Pound. Harvey Price. Rochelle Sharp. Elliot Smith. Darcy Tempest. Alice Walsh. Lily Watson. Nicholas West. for the degree of Bachelor of Arts in English and Linguistics, Ruby Crowhurst. And Trina Koo. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in French and German Language, Roseanne Evans. Heather Marlowe. Ellen Stanton. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in French and German Language with a year abroad, Samuel Carrington. Hannah Davis. Adam Hexley. Verity Jordan. Joseph Kirkwood. Grace Waddington. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in French and Italian Language, Eleanor Griffin. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in French and Italian Language with a year abroad, Eleanor Crawford. Alex Joseland. Madeline Ord. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in French and Linguistics with a year abroad, Catherine Bottomley. Sarah Donkin. Charlotte Spencer. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in French and Philosophy, Idris Ben Khalid Mihiri. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in French and Spanish Language, Thomas Giles. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in French and Spanish Language with a year abroad, Alexandra Bartholomew. Harriet Belger. Liberty Butler. Oliver Davis. Maria Harrison. Miranda Ivnitsky. Sophie Robinson. Sorry. French and Spanish. Ruth Ann Hill. I'm sorry. Sorry. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in German and Italian Language with a year abroad, Olivia Fraquelli. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in German and Linguistics with a year abroad, Beth White. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in German and Spanish Language with a year abroad, Olivia Bridges. Stephanie Carter. Joanna Grogan Ainsworth. Emily Meisen. Sophie Swarbrick. for the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Italian and Linguistics with a year abroad, Bethany Nightingale. Molly Petherbridge. Rebecca Tarrant. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Italian and Spanish Language, Dennis Maximenko. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Italian and Spanish Language with a year abroad, Emma Burmey. Amy Foy. Mark O'Donnell. Jennifer Tobin. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Linguistics, Abigail Byram. Michelle Bebbington. Hal Bowden. Laura Brogdon. Hannah Galeb. Juliet Hill. Rebecca Lee. Rosalind Sword. Danhi Wang. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Linguistics with French, Siu Tim Quan. Leah Watson. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Linguistics with German, Rachel Bamford. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Linguistics with Spanish, Sophie Bennett. Madeline Lloyd. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Philosophy and Linguistics, Robert Brown. Victoria Winters. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Spanish and Linguistics with a year abroad, Rosie Landers. Catherine Phillips. Naomi Thomas.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ensemble et Anonimi will perform Here Comes the Sun by the Beatles, followed by Run to You by Pentatonix.
Here comes the sun.
Here comes the sun.
Here comes the sun.
Here comes the sun.
Little darling, it's been a long, cold, lonely winter. Little darling, it seems like years since it's been here.
Here comes the sun. Here comes the sun.
Here comes the sun.
And I said, it's all right. Little darling, the smiles we send into their faces.
Here comes the sun.
Little darling, it seems like since it's been here,
since it's been here.
Here comes the sun. Here comes the sun. And I say, it's all right.
acting Vice-Chancellor and President. For anybody who has ever met Sir Christopher O'Donnell, the words calm, nurturing, and compassionate will resonate as a description of this remarkable business leader and remarkable man. Sir Chris is also a very modest individual, and as such, he will doubtless find the short introduction to his many achievements embarrassing. Whenever complimented on any of his many achievements, Sir Chris will suggest that it is the team around him, not him alone, that should be credited. Indeed, when receiving his knighthood, Sir Chris commented, "It was nice to get personal recognition, but it's as much about the company." It is perhaps in part this self-effacement that has made him so highly regarded by all who meet him. Born in Sheffield, Sir Chris endured a tough schooling at an all-boys Catholic grammar school before studying mechanical engineering at Imperial College London, followed by the London Business School. He says that he fell into the field of medical technology by accident. But a closer look into Sir Chris's career suggests that there is no accident in the choices of organisations that he has gone to lead and influence. Indeed, the guiding motto of Smith and Nephew, the medical device company in which Sir Chris held a position on the board for more than 15 years, is "Life Unlimited." This is an aspiration that motivated Sir Chris to work so hard, to develop bold business strategies and to see them through, and that also drives his desire to nurture ideas and people. Sir Chris secured his first job at Vickers, then one of Britain's largest engineering firms. He was put in charge of its medical engineering business when he was just 26. The division was up for sale and, to quote, "in a terrible state" when Sir Chris took over. Despite his relative lack of experience, over the course of 10 years, Sir Chris was able to get it back into profit and indeed enable it to flourish. Sir Chris then went on to join Smith and Nephew in 1988, taking a seat on the board in 1992. Just days after his succession to the role of CEO, the company was taken out of the FTSE 100 index. But rather than just putting a sticking plaster on this poor performance, Sir Chris recognised the need for a radical plan to shift the focus of the company, to concentrate on specialist wound dressings, keyhole surgery equipment, bone repair products, and artificial hips and knees. Under Sir Chris, Smith and Nephew invested in new research, eventually setting up their global research headquarters here in York on the University Science Park. Smith and Nephew went on to pioneer the principle of keeping wounds moist rather than dry. This overturned generations of established clinical practice. One particular dressing developed by Smith and Nephew built on a technique for incorporating silver into the dressing, a technique first recognised in Egyptian times, and a technique subsequently used on burn victims of the Bali bombings and to treat people injured in the September 11 attack on the Pentagon in the USA. Under Sir Chris's leadership, Smith and Nephew reinvented itself as a growth company, and the investments made in research and development, together with the doubling of the sales force, increased the turnover of the company to around $3 billion. All the while, Sir Chris and his colleagues were driven by the desire to fundamentally improve lives, an approach that he termed a purpose beyond profit. While the consequences of Chris's vision and hard work may have been responsible for saving and improving the lives of millions of people around the world, there is perhaps Smith and Nephew's support for one individual that particularly resonated minds with the public. In 2002, Smith and Nephew were responsible for keeping England's World Cup hopes alive when they provided an ultrasound bone healing device that helped mend David Beckham's second metatarsal. England were, of course, knocked out by Brazil in the quarterfinals, and one can't help but wonder, had the team been managed by Sir Chris O'Donnell rather than Sven-Göran Eriksson, might they actually have gone on to win the 2002 World Cup? In 2007, the University of York was fortunate to appoint Sir Chris as Chair of Council, the university's supreme governing body. For 10 years, Sir Chris applied the same clarity of vision and purpose to the University of York as he had so famously done at Vickers and Smith and Nephew. As Chair of Council, Sir Chris focused his attention on raising the university's international profile and increasing the overall size of our academic departments, student population, and our campus footprint. Sir Chris was just as eager to mentor academic colleagues and the university's leadership team as he was to ensure that the student voice was represented at the highest level. At the time of his retirement, the then USU president, Minnie Beach, commented, "From the moment I walked into council as an intimidated new officer, you made me feel welcome, comfortable, and able to question papers and voice my opinions." It is also notable that during Sir Chris's tenure as Chair of Council, the university achieved 13 Athena Swan Awards for supporting the progression of women scientists, achievements for which I am personally very grateful. Sir Chris could always be counted on to support colleagues in their career aspirations, whatever their background or gender. And finally, in conferring this award, we wish to pay tribute to Sir Chris's work on behalf of the homeless charity Emmaus, where Sir Chris and his wife, Lady Mia, continue to change lives as long-serving trustees. Emmaus recognises that overcoming homelessness requires more than having a roof over your head, and critically, the charity helps people to regain their self-worth, which brings us neatly back to the theme of lives unlimited. Acting Vice-Chancellor and President, in recognition of Sir Chris O'Donnell's leadership in business and the indelible mark that he's left upon the University of York, it is my enormous pleasure and privilege to present Sir Chris O'Donnell for the award of Doctor of the University, honoris causa.
Well, I'd like to thank Debbie for those very kind words. Acting Vice-Chancellor, learned professors, graduates and graduands, since this is a split audience at the moment, families and friends. Well, if only my lecturers and tutors at Imperial College could see me now as a doctor of the University of York, they would be astounded. I received approximately weekly notifications of impending favour during my third year at university. I had slightly different priorities to the staff in the mechanical engineering department. I was the student union president in the days before sabbaticals. I played football for the university, and I was also in the third year of my degree. And roughly, I organized myself along those three priorities. I guess you could say there were some life skills choices in there, because in the end, I was able to get a degree, although it was a close-run thing. And I took away with me some important skills for the future in terms of decision-making, priorities, capability for intense work to catch up on all the stuff I was missing, and an ability to plan things out for the future. I'm very grateful to the university for this honour and for the recognition of my efforts and hopefully the contribution that I've been able to make to the medical technology sector and to the university, which I've thoroughly enjoyed all of. There's a bit of a common theme that between the companies that I worked for, and particularly Smith and Nephew, and the university, which is their British institutions, which are facing a global challenge. And that global challenge comes from organizations in the US or Europe, and increasingly China, that are much larger, much better financed, and generally have more resources and deeper pockets. So it's important to figure out how to deal with that. At Smith & Nephew, there are, of the top 20 medical technology companies in the world, 18 are in the US, one is in Germany, and one is in the UK. So that's a really pretty big challenge. The US market is 40% of the world market, so you've got to figure out a way to succeed. And that means you've got to do things better, and you've got to do things with flair, originality, and innovation. And those are the things that I've sought to bring forward in my business career and actually subsequently at the university here. In terms of business, innovation means new products, things that help people regain their lives or make their lives better. And obviously, if you do innovate, you have some significant successes, you hope. And indeed, with Smith & Nephew, we were fortunate. We had some simple wins and we had some complex wins. And the company still stands as one of the leading innovators in the field of medical technology. But naturally, you have some wins and you have some failures too. That's the nature of how these things work. When I came as chair to York, the similarity struck me. York is a relatively new, i.e. 50 years new, a bit less than that then, about 45 years, and a relatively small university. It is competing with giant, well-financed institutions in what is truly a global marketplace for knowledge and information. And it's really critical, obviously, that the university succeed. How is it going to do that? How does this affect you as graduates and graduands? Well, the university needs to do things better than the competition. We need to perform as a university effectively. We need to do things with innovation, flair, and originality. And that has been a hallmark, actually, of York since its inception. And that's one of the reasons why I was very happy to accept the offer of being chair here. The Department of Language and Linguistic Science was one of the first departments in this country to really systematically study linguistic and develop linguistic science. It stands as a beacon of excellence in this country and indeed internationally. And that reflects on your standing as graduates. You've got an additional skill base, and the reputation of the department will help you in your future careers. At the time I joined, the university was setting up a law school. We decided, not me, I hasten to add, the university collectively decided on a novel, innovative teaching method to lead case-driven teaching. Many other university departments have followed since, but that enabled a new law department to build a reputation and franchise that is quite outstanding for a department that's less than 15 years old. And the recruiters who come to the department are a manifestation of that. And that should also benefit the graduands who are about to come on the stage here and graduate from the Department of Law here. The second big challenge, though, facing the university at the time I joined was the campus here, on what is now Heslington West, was the only campus. It was cramped, it was overutilized, all the utilization figures were more than 100% during normal working hours, and there was no room for expansion. There was actually no room for a law department until we bought the big green fields at the time between here and the A64, and then started the build out of Heslington East. Now, for a university with at the time a cash flow of £15 million, to commit to spending £500 million on a new expansion campus was a pretty brave and well thought through step. And we were able to do that despite the fact that the financial crisis showed up in the middle of it and made the availability of money and the issues surrounding expansion projects much more difficult. And today, we have a complete campus on Heslington East. Unfortunately, some things got delayed by the financial crisis, and I do apologize to those of you, particularly from the law department, who've had to put up with inadequate catering and social facilities for a considerable period of time, now remedied. But we do have that space in place, and this will stand us well for the future, where the university is stepping into even more uncertain times. So that was a really important focus of all my time at the university, and has enabled the university to stand up very proudly today across all its departments. So at the same time, we tried to maintain the innovation focus, but we dropped some of the markers. The university, because of its high focus on this project, slid back a little bit in student surveys and in research. But having sorted out and got this moving, the staff particularly have focused on rebuilding the research program, which an initiative which Debbie has led dramatically successfully, so that our research income and research positioning has grown fantastically, and our new York teaching, York pedagogy, which is giving us a terrific standing in the academic community as a methodology of teaching, and giving our students, you are giving the university now the highest ratings it has ever had. This is a tremendous achievement for the staff at the university. So, today is graduation day for you all. You've all worked tremendously hard to get to this place. You've been successful at school, you've been successful at university, and I very much hope that you'll step forward and build on what you've learned here, both in terms of degrees and in terms of life skills, as you go out into a rapidly changing, digitizing, but exciting world. And I wish you the best of good fortune. I think there is one thing that is worthwhile remembering, though, and that is life is not usually just a smooth path upwards to success. That actually, you'll have to do a bit of experimentation as you go forward. And it's a big, wide world out there. There are no safety nets like there are at university or at school. And I hope you seize those opportunities. And you'll be successful with most of them. But it is okay to say this one hasn't worked out. This one has failed. And actually, I met a young lady in her 30s who was a graduate from York. And she said to me, at my graduation, the honorary graduate said very clearly, look, it's okay to fail. If you have a problem, the problem doesn't define you. It's how you deal with it, and how you, together with your friends and families, tackle that going forward. And the resilience and the life skills that you've built here, and I hope your friends in the York community, will enable you to have highly successful careers in whatever you choose. So thank you all very much for listening. Thank you, Acting Vice-Chancellor, and thank you, Debbie.
Vice-Chancellor, I have the honour to present the following candidates. For the degree of Doctor of Philosophy in Law, for research in UK's responsibility to protect Syrian refugees, Chloe Gilden. For research in the efficient breach of commercial contracts, Liam Kildington. research in a study of the nature and function of mere equities, Jack Wells. For the degree of Master of Laws in International Human Rights Law and Practice, Michelle Tejedila Orozco. For the degree of Master of Laws in Legal and Political Theory, Rupali Chowdhury. James Leake. For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law, Rachel Adam Smith. Ali Agar. Ayatollah Taiwo Akinnoso. Mia Ali. Maren Andreu Gallego. Jake Arnold. Mevish Ashraf. Manila Banda. Lewis Barton. Sasha Beaumont Hodges. Sophie Blackwell. Holly Boland. Mark Boyer. Lydia Brame. Lucy Brierley. Christian Putins. Zara Kane. Madeline Cannell. Joseph Cannon. Jade Kareen. Katie Charlton. Catherine Chick. Harry Clark. Ben Clark. Alexander Claiborne. Stephanie Cohen. Elizabeth Collings. Eleanor Coombs. Anna Cooper. Manon Cote. Bhavan Singh Dood. Eleonora DeFranco. Tefadatswa Durarimwe. Jacob Easton. Alice Edinburgh. Polly Edwards. Amber Ferguson. Eleanor Fields. Ross George. Yara Guri. Alexandra Gibson. David Gibson. Terry Gore. Colm Goff. Zane Giovanni. Jordan Grace. Doruk Gunalk. Samuel Guy. Helena Hain. Jessica Harrison. Adam Hart. Ben Heathfield. Megan Hicklin. Harry Hyam. Adam Hill. Talana Hodgson-Baines. Megan Holman. James Hopkins. Billy Howarth Lee. Ellie Hughes. Lucy Hughes. Lydia Isaacs. Amanda Jackson. Leo Jarvis. Yasmin Johnson. Edward Jones. Zara Kausa. Evan Kelly. Daniel Kerr Dando. Aisha Khan. Emma Kostick. Constantina, Michaela Kotsupa Santos. Jane Bolujo Kubalati. Rose Lagnardo. Lillian Lamb. Andrew Layton. James Ledley. Isaac Lee Howarth. Marianne Linskill. Ludovico Lugnani. Derek Liu. Mark Luxford. Leviza Mahmood. Yin Y. Thomas Mack. Jack Manton. Georgia Susanna Manu. Adam McDermott. Lauren McGowan. Harrison Meadows. Seamus Merrin. Katie Mitchell. Greta Mokut. Ryan Paul Sanderson Morris. Isaac Meyer. Emma O'Connell. Panina Onchera. Laura Park. Nicholas Parthenopoulos. Hannah Patterson. Anya Perry. Simal Premaratna. Samantha Price. Amelia Priest. Jennifer Proven. Daniel Redmond. Hala Riyad. Carter Rich. Jessica Richardson. Madalena Rodriguez Marcus. Jordan Rogers. Naomi Sampson. Lucy Shackleton. Matthew Sharland. Hannah Simpson. Chloe Smith. Ben Stevenson. Lauren Stewart Brown. Alexander Stewart Marino. Lottie Stone. Rahama Tanimu. Charlotte Taylor. Rachel Taylor. Benjamin Thompson. Catherine Thompson. Suzanne Thordyke. Jennifer Tilston. Susan Town. Charlotte Venters. Harry Vowse. Luke Walsh. Gus Walter. Natalie Walk. Maxim Warner Housego. Kate Wheeler. Lewis White. Bethany Williams. Max Williams. Katie Wilshire. Enya Wong. Demi Wilger. David Yeselmark. Say Yip. Graham Musician. For the degree of Bachelor of Laws in Law with a year abroad, Kiran Doshi. Jordan Fry. Henry Smith. Tom Smith. For the degree of Bachelor of Laws, Senior Status in Law, Asina Erin Arioglu. Emily Brown. Shayla Domin. Marina Sarah E. Gobran. Eamon Jaffrey. And Anna Rivera Bejarano.
It is my enormous pleasure to introduce Rose Ann Evans, our student orator, who will speak on behalf of the class of 2019. Our student orators have been invited to speak in recognition of their hard work on behalf of the student community and commitment to their studies. Our speakers have both pursued the most enriching experience they could during their time at York, as well as giving back to their community. On behalf of the class of 2019, I give you Rose Ann Evans.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, fellow graduates, I'd like to start by saying congratulations to everyone graduating today, and well done for managing not to fall over when coming to get your certificates. That's what I was worried about today. But today is a day to reflect upon our time at university and to celebrate our achievements. Whilst our degrees have equipped us with a certain level of qualification and skills that we can use in the future, such as communication skills, understanding and openness towards other cultures, or the ability to problem solve, we are graduating with knowledge and experiences beyond those of our degree. Whether you have, for example, helped a housemate in need, been part of a society, overcome adversity, or been part of a college committee, each one of us has had experiences and encounters outside of our studies, some positive and some negative, that will help to shape our futures. For me, one such experience was being awarded a Santander scholarship to study psychology in America. Now, I've just graduated in French and German, so when I arrived at the airport, I could easily have turned around. about to study a subject I was quite unfamiliar with in a country that I had never visited. I was afraid. Afraid of failing, afraid of the unknown, and afraid of stepping outside of my comfort zone. But then I remembered something that my granddad had told me a few years before. He said that I could do anything I wanted to. I just had to overcome the fear that was getting in the way. This is easier said than done, but very true nonetheless. My time in America was challenging, but I came back a more rounded and confident individual and realized that I would actually like to pursue a career in psychology in the future. Often it's by both facing our fears and putting ourselves outside of our comfort zones that we're able to learn, to grow, and to develop as individuals. I know that every single person in this room will have faced and overcome challenges during their time at university, whether academic or personal. But you have shown resilience and perseverance, and they are two skills which are very much needed in the world today. But we must also thank and remember those who have walked alongside us and helped us along the way. Those like my granddad, who are no longer with us but who continue to impact our lives. Family, friends, lecturers and university staff who have encouraged and supported us, and anyone else who has been part of our individual journeys. I'd particularly like to thank my family and friends and my church family for always believing in me. University staff and my disability mentors for supporting me throughout my degree, and the university community for being such kind and accepting individuals. And thank you also to sponsors and donors for investing in students' futures by generously giving their time and providing funding to allow students to access a whole range of opportunities. And a special thanks goes to my York Futures Scholarship donor for investing in my future. So now, as we begin the next chapter of our lives, whether that be undertaking postgraduate studies, having some time out, or going into the world of work, it is time to invest in our own futures. We must seek and seize opportunities, allow others to help and support us, and strive to achieve our potential in spite of challenging situations that may come our way. I have no doubt that everyone here has the potential to flourish. So once again, congratulations and good luck with whatever lies ahead. Thank you.
Acting Vice-Chancellor, it's a great honour and a privilege to introduce our honorary graduand, Dr. Ronald Kaplan. Ron Kaplan has contributed over a span of 50 years to the development of the field of linguistics and the development of applications in language technology based on formal discoveries about linguistic systems. He has held positions of management and leadership in industry and key academic positions, including a professorship at Stanford University for the past 40 years. He holds 36 patents in science and technology, which have had extraordinary impact. Every time you enter text into a computer, phone, or tablet for texting, word processing, or to search for something, you're using technology built on Ron's discoveries. Ron grew up in California and took his first degree in mathematics and psychology from the University of California, Berkeley. Also knowing some linguistics, he was inspired by a quote from Noam Chomsky that envisioned how a generative grammar might be embedded within a model of human language production and comprehension. Ron was a pioneer in both computational linguistics and psycholinguistics. In the early 1970s, he wrote the grammar of the so-called Lunar System, which was the first substantial natural language question-answer system. NASA had sent pieces of moon rocks brought back from Apollo 11, brought back 50 years ago next week, sent pieces of moon rocks to lunar geologists all over the world, and then collected the results of analysis in a database. NASA commissioned the Lunar System so that their scientists could easily query the database. It was the first time ever that you could ask a computer something like, do any samples contain more than 13% aluminium? And then follow it with, and which are those samples? Alongside this work, Ron completed his PhD in psychology at Harvard University. His PhD research is a very early example of the area we now call psycholinguistics. He then went on to make several foundational contributions to the field of linguistics, co-developing the first constraint-based theory of syntax and co-developing the field of computational morphology. This led him to create and lead the research group for natural language theory and technology at the Xerox Palo Alto Research Center in California. His work there on the core mathematical properties of human language led to his major contributions beyond the field of linguistics. It's easier if I present these wider contributions as two themes. First, the words of language, and then second, the sentences of language as communication. As a scientist, Ron was interested in the theoretical properties of linguistic systems. The abstract investigation of those properties led him to make two significant proofs, which in turn led to technological applications. The first was the proof of a theorem about the computational properties that would underlie a system of spell checking. As a result, Ron helped develop the first spell checkers in the 1980s, producing small portable spell checkers. This further enabled the development of fast small dictionaries. It could be applied to any language, and also to the development of the first electronic books. The second proof was a theorem about finite state transducers, which sounds very dry, but it concerned the computability of the actual forms of words in any language. The finite state technology that was subsequently developed is the foundation of almost every current text processing application. Whenever you enter text into any digital device or do any kind of search, it is the technology that figures out what word or words you intend and in what language. Starting in the 1990s, personal and office computers became ubiquitous, all containing the technology I've just described. More recent developments mean that we now often enter data by speaking rather than by typing, but it's the same data. The other theme of Ron's work is concerned with actual human communication, not just with words. The lunar system built for NASA was fundamentally a search-driven system. It works with facts. But even in the 1970s, Ron was interested in how to develop a different kind of system, a more realistic conversational system. A relevant analogy would be the difference between looking up your medical symptoms in a book or talking to a doctor about them. In the last decade, Ron has worked as a senior scientist for Nuance Communications and then Amazon to develop what he calls conversational search. Nuance is a world leader in speech technology, which is looking to provide smart systems that take over once the speech signal is decoded. Amazon is a company that probably will be known to all of you. Once fully developed, conversational search will mean that we can interact with technology as if we were talking to a doctor or a travel agent, rather than looking up information in a book or a brochure. That's what's coming next. Acting Vice Chancellor, it is therefore with great pleasure that I present to you Dr. Ronald Kaplan for the degree of Doctor of the University, honoris causa.
Acting Vice Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to express my deep appreciation to the university for this tremendous honor, and I would especially like to thank Professor Sells for his very kind introduction. I want to offer my congratulations to all of the graduates today in your areas of law, languages, and linguistics. Your parents are rightfully proud of the achievements and accomplishments that this event celebrates. There is always some uncertainty, however, in a transition to a new stage of life. But I think the law and language graduates and all their families probably have a good sense of how they will make use of the knowledge they have acquired in their studies here. For the linguistics graduates, though, the future may seem a little less clear. I can still remember my own parents' reaction when I came home from university about 50 years ago and told them I'd finally figured out what I was going to be. I was going to be a psycholinguist. I could see several emotions flit across their faces: confusion, anxiety, concern, fear. They relaxed only after I got my degree and announced that I'd actually gotten a job. I was hired to be a scientist in computational psycholinguistics at the new research center that Peter mentioned, the Xerox Corporation had established in Palo Alto, California. In the early 1970s, computers were huge machines that were accessible only to people with very special skills. But PARC, the Palo Alto Research Center, was organized a vision of a personal computer, that there would come a time when ordinary people each would have their own computers and their own computer, and those computers would assist people in their everyday lives. A bunch of engineering problems had to be solved: how to make computers cheap enough so that ordinary people could buy them, how to make them fit under a desk or in a satchel that you could take to the beach. But they also had to have enough capabilities so that the cost and the effort would be worthwhile. So a bunch of engineering problems had to be solved. The engineering was difficult, but that wasn't the most challenging part of the vision. The deeper and more important question was, how are ordinary people, not specialists, going to interact with these personal computers? How are they going to tell the computers what to do? How will they figure out whether the computers had actually done the right thing? We explored two approaches to the problem of computer-human interaction. The easy and most immediate solution was the one that you are all familiar with. PARC researchers developed the mouse, window, icon, menu interface that is now commonplace across the world. But clearly, language is the most natural and efficient way for ordinary people to exchange information and to express most directly their needs and desires. There are things you can convey in language that you cannot communicate by pointing and clicking. So we also set out to create a family of language-based interfaces. This was more ambitious and much harder, and many researchers have worked on this problem over the years. Systems have advanced. There's great value in the search engines, the translators, even the smart assistants and smart speakers that we now use every day. But it is no secret that there are frustrating gaps in what these systems understand. Modern computer interfaces still don't pay enough attention to general linguistic insights and to the properties of particular languages. And that, I think, is a major factor in their continuing poor performance. The skills and knowledge that today's linguistics graduates have acquired are still needed to humanize the ever more complicated technologies that ordinary people will encounter. Beyond technology per se, there is no question that we live in increasingly complex and tumultuous times. As you graduate today, you know that a changing world will present unforeseen challenges and new opportunities. In your time at university, you have all become specialists in your particular fields of study. And you've gained an understanding of human behavior and values more generally. Going forward, I hope you will all find ways to apply what you have learned here to help create technology that is more human and a future that is more humane. So again, I thank the university for this great honor, and I wish you all the best of luck in your future endeavors.
So we're very nearly finished. Firstly, I need to confer awards on all those students who've elected to receive their degrees in absentia. I'd like to congratulate Ron. I'd like to congratulate Sir Chris. I'd like to congratulate all of you on your graduation. I'd like to now ask, if I may, our guests to stand, not the graduates. So if the guests could stand, that would be great. You can do what you like. So, ladies and gentlemen, now is our last chance to congratulate the class of 2019, to wish them well in their future and whatever journeys they take. Please. I wonder if our graduates could now stand. So again, congratulations to you, but as you've heard, as you know, you haven't got here without some help and support from the staff at the university, academic staff, our professional service and technical staff, your family, your friends, people who've supported you through thick and thin, and also people who've given you quite a lot of money. So now's your chance, your chance to say thank you, please. Thank you. I now declare the congregation closed. Please remain standing.